Good morning, everybody. Good to be here this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, once again, we give you thanks, God, and we give you praise, God, for all things. Father, we thank you, God, that you've allowed us to come together to worship you, Lord, this morning. We ask, God, again, this day, God, that the Holy Ghost would be our teacher and show us, God, what you would have us to know. God, this word will not return you void, but it will accomplish what you will this morning, God. God, we ask for a mighty anointing upon each and every one, God, that hears this word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Revelation. That actually means to take the cover off. You know, and we'll go back to Mark chapter 9. Verse 1. And this is Jesus speaking. And he said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that there be some of them that stand here which shall not taste death till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power. Now, you would think, you know, that can't happen. But John saw it. God allowed John to see it. This is the vision of John while he was a prisoner on the Isle of Patmos, and it was located in the Aegean Sea off the coast of Turkey, some say Greece, but it's written somewhere around AD 95. The worst political prisoners were confined to this island, and now this man John, they tried their best to shut him up. He was preaching about this man Jesus Christ, and the Romans didn't like that, and they wanted to shut him up. And I heard someone teaching on this one time. They said they actually boiled a man in oil, and he still wouldn't die. But this is the thing we got to understand: if we've got a destiny, then we'll stick to it. God will see if it comes to pass. I mean, John had a destiny here to write to the world the things that will come to pass. And so they put him out here on this island. They couldn't shut him up. They put him out here on this island because he'd starve to death. Yeah. But you got to, that's another thing you got to understand. God will take care of you. He'll see to your needs. You know, even Paul said, my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And so, John, even though he had a hard time, and sometimes we're going to have some hard times to get to our destiny. This is something that has been a fallacy in Christianity. You know, when I get saved, everything's going to be okay. People don't understand. You got every devil in the universe against you then. You know, Peter said it's not God's will that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. But, on the other hand, it's the devil wanting to take everyone he can to hell. And so he's going to do everything. And it's sad to say, but he's doing a pretty good job right now. I mean, churches are having a hard time. Ministries are having a hard time. Ministries are closing. Well, yeah, I mean, you know, it's like, there are people in this church right now. Years ago, you would have never thought that they'd left. But, I mean, you know, some that I know of, they're not going anywhere. They just got out and, you know. But you see, the thing Jesus said, why? Those that endure to the end, the same shall be saved. not how you start out, it's how you finish. You know? Yeah. You know, I like what I was like what Joyce Meyer always said. She said, getting pregnant's easy, giving birth's hard. You know, I mean, that, when you get down to the end of the way, you're going to have more opposition than you've ever had. It's just the way it works. So, let's start with verse 1. It said, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants the things which must shortly come to pass, and he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. Now, that word shortly come to pass, it actually means come to pass quickly. You know, when the tribulation hour begins, it's only going to last 7 years according to the word of God. And so there's going to be a whole lot of things happen within 7 years' time. So that will come nice quickly. And I think we can all agree that you see the things today accelerating. Things are moving faster than they've ever moved in our lifetime. Can't kind of get one under control. So we got another. We got. I think we've got two right now. There's another one I heard of. I can't remember what it is. You know. And they said even polio now is beginning to come back. I saw that on the news. See that's what Jesus said. He prophesied this in the 21st chapter of Luke. He said in the last days that one of the signs is pestilence, which is plagues of diseases. You know, and people can't figure out, well, what's going on? He's at the door. Verse 2 said, who bear record of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he saw. He said, blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. Now, this is the only book in the Bible that is said that if you read it, you will be blessed. You know, of course, we will be blessed with others, but I mean, this is the one that specifically says we will be blessed. But I want people to notice this one thing here. He said to hear the words of the prophecy and keep those things. See, that's the key of it. We've got a lot of people listening to the word of God, but they're not keeping it. Even in the book of Hebrews, it said, fail not to assemble yourself together. You know, people are failing to even assemble. He said, and John to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is, which was, and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 11. Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 4. It said, and there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his root. Now he's speaking of Jesus here. And the Spirit, now listen to the Spirit he speaks of here. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, Spirit of knowledge and a fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. Said, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth, and he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. This is basically the same prophecy now that God is going to give of Jesus. And from Jesus Christ, verse 5, it says, from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. What else could we have than a Savior like that, that's willing to die for us? For, you know, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. So Jesus did it for us, so we don't have to do it. Verse 6. Now this is a key verse for us. And hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. Unto him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Go to Ecclesiastes 8 and 4. Ecclesiastes 8, verse 4. Now listen to what it said. It said, where the word of a king is, there is power. This is something that if you've heard me teach from the day I started here. Be careful what you say. There's power in what you say. You know, you're going to have what you say. If you talk negative all the time, that's the way you're going to live. If you talk sickness all the time, that's what you're going to have. But people don't seem to realize that, you know. First Peter 2 and 9. Verse 9 says, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. We are a royal priesthood. You know, this is another thing most people don't realize. They don't really know who they are in Jesus Christ. They talk like the world, they act like the world, except they say they're going to heaven. But that, you know, even Paul told Titus, you know, that we are a peculiar people. And that word peculiar, it means beyond usual. You're not like, we're not to be like everybody else. I mean, that's the bottom line. Seven. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all the kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. Let's go to 1 Thessalonians 4. Very familiar scripture to all of us. We all know it. 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 and 17. Paul says here, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of the archangel. Notice that word, the. The is specific. Most of the modern translations, though, that would say and. But I think King James is right. Because in Jude 9, it specified, Michael, the archangel. See, this is the thing that people don't understand. We've got the devil, he is the ruler of the second heaven. And when the rapture happens, we got to go through that. So, we got a military escort out of here. That's comforting to know. He said, the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, so shall we ever be with the Lord. That's comforting to know. When you read on in the book of Revelation, wouldn't you hate to be here during that time, that awful time? I mean, I feel sorry for the people that say they're Christians but believe they're going through it. You're going to have, if you believe you're going through it, you're going to go through it. Because you're going to have what you say. Verse 8 said, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, saith the Lord, which is, which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. Now we know the Alpha and the Omega is the first and the last letters of the Greek alphabet. So Jesus is everything. And that's the bottom line. He needs anything you need, And, but most people are not, we would say, they're not tapping in to what's available to them. We use the old analogy, you may have $1 million laying in the bank, but if you don't write a check on it, it's going to do you no good. Yeah. And that's the way of our faith. If we don't use it, the old saying is, use it or lose it, you can do it. And that's what's happened to a lot of people. They have not used their faith. They have lost it. They're back out here, they're like the prodigal son. They're back out here in the hog pen. That was a very detestable thing for a Jewish boy to be in the hog pen. And we've got Christians that are back out here in the hog pen alive. And they don't need to be there. But I do pray that they'll be like the prodigal son, that one day they'll come to themselves. Verse 9. And I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. Well, you see, that's what I was saying a while ago. That's why John's here. He's banished to the isle of Patmos for the preaching of the word of God. And there are people out in the world today that's trying to do the same things in the church that they did to John. They're trying to get rid of everything of God. I don't know what's going to happen to the people of the United States. We got to have a mindset, a change in mindset in this country. Government is not going to fix this thing. It's only going to be through the power of the Holy Ghost that this country changes. Verse 10. That I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard it behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. Now, a lot of times in the Greek, I don't have this one. I don't think this one is exactly that, the same. But most of the time in Greek, a trumpet is the shofar. But you notice it said the voice of the trumpet. I heard a person teaching some time ago. They said that the shofar sounded like the voice of God. And when a shofar is blown, every demon in hell trembles. You know, there are people that don't understand what a shofar is. But a shofar is a very important thing in the Bible. When you go through that, a trumpet is mentioned so many different times. He said that he was on the Lord's Day. The prior New Testament said that when he was on the Sabbath. Verse 11 said, I'm Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and what thou seest write in a book and send it unto seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, unto Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. Now, he said, write it in a book. Actually, what John did, he wrote it on sheets of paper, papyrus, I can't pronounce it anyway. And then it was rolled up into a scroll, is the way it was done. It wasn't into a book as we know it today. We'll go another verse to you. He said, and I turned to see the voice and spoke with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks was one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girded about the pap of a golden girdle. And this pap, this was a wide belt in the upper middle of the chest. The priest wore this. Now listen to how he described him. And his head and his hairs were white like wool, and as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet were like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. Now this brass that we're talking about here, this was a polished brass that they could actually make like a mirror out of. It was that clear. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun that shineth in his strength. Ephesians. Ephesians 6:17. Ephesians 6 and 17. This is the whole armor that Paul's talking about here. In verse 17 he said, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The Word of God is our weapon against the devil. Jesus used it when Jesus was tempted. He used it, and we should too. But here's the sad thing, baby. Most Christians don't even know what the Word of God says. And they all got a Bible. Most of them are pretty dusty. We, just like we need natural food, we need spiritual food every day. And if we just read two or three verses, that would be better than nothing, you know. But that's the thing about it, as I've been saying. Too many of our people that say they're Christians are starving to death. Verse 16 said, and he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. And when I saw it, I fell at his feet dead. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying, unto me, fear not, I am the first and the last. Now, we've got a lot of people that don't believe in being, as we say, plain in the Spirit. Right here, John, it happened to John. I remember there's a famous preacher, Benny Hinn, visited his city back many years ago. And if you ever watch any of the Benny Hinn's, you know, I mean, there ain't many people that don't get to stand up at Benny Hinn's. But this pastor, he made fun of Benny Hinn. He said the Spirit won't knock you down, it raises you up. And everything in the world happened to that pastor. His wife left him. I don't know what happened to that man. You do not make fun of the Holy Ghost. The things of the Holy Ghost, you better just be quiet if you don't understand it. Because if you want to know, he will show you. It may take a while, but he will show you what you need to know. Well, let's stop right there on verse 18.